Welcome back, It's Nine, and today we have a pretty massive video. This is all about an interview with Herman Hulst, and he answers a lot of questions, and this is all over the PlayStation blog, and there was also a podcast done with an audio interview. Now, I want to go over what was said here, as there is so much news in this. There's a lot of reveals, and some good, some bad, and some may have some of you mixed on how you feel about it. There's a lot of content here, and I will have timestamps in the description and the pinned comment, and there'll be chapters as well if you want to just hop to the points that are most important to you. Now, first off, let's talk about the question where he is asked, do you see single-player narrative games as essential to the PlayStation Studios console experience? And Herman says, absolutely. Single-player, narrative-driven games, that's our DNA. PlayStation Studios have made, in my mind, some of the most memorable narrative experiences available. We love making them, and we'll keep making them as long as gamers enjoy them. For me, the idea of sitting down on a Friday night with a brand new world and a great story to explore, that sounds pretty perfect, right? We also want to make sure that we're creating a variety of experiences for our audiences, franchises, new IP, big games, smaller and more innovative games, single-player stories, and multiplayer. Who says that multiplayer experiences cannot have great stories, right? So here he confirms that, yes, IPs is a thing. They're focused on multiplayer. They're focused on small games, bigger games, because there's been a lot of criticisms towards PlayStation in not doing multiplayer games, in not having smaller projects, you know, and only focusing on the already solidified first-party games like Uncharted, for example. And this is them saying, hey, that is not the case. And so this is a positive thing. This is how I walk away from this, because story-driven single-player experiences is the way I want to experience video games for the most part. So I'm happy to hear that that's going to remain. Now, after that, he's asked, we've seen the announcement of Haven from Jade Raymond, as well as a bunch of industry veterans, and more recently, Firewalk, which also has some top names from the industry. How do you see partnership like these fitting into the larger PlayStation Studios vision? Herman says, yeah, you know, these partnerships are very exciting. You could, I guess, make a distinction between development teams who are part of Sony, like Naughty Dog, Insomniac, Media Molecule, Sucker Punch, and so on, and then development teams who are working with us like partners, Haven, Firewalk, but also teams we've worked with over years, like Kojima Productions, From Software. To me, in many ways, there really is no difference. They are all PlayStation Studios. We are, at the end of the day, a creator-led organization, which to me means that we want to find the best possible development studios in the world and help them passionately pursue their ideas. To me, it's important that PlayStation Studios is a place that allows creators to join us and do the best work of their career. That's really what I'm after. Now, if you didn't catch something very important in here, when they say PlayStation Studios, they're not referring to studios they own. They are referring to any game that is exclusive to their platform. So, for example, Haven, Firewalk, Kojima Productions. So, those would be involved and included when they mention 25 exclusives, over half being new IP. He is then asked, are you able to give us a snapshot of the total number of titles that PlayStation Studios are currently developing for PS4 or PS5? Herman's response is, well, we have a lot going on right now. PlayStation Studios have more than 25 titles in development. Almost half of these are new IP. The other half, they are titles that are set in franchises that PlayStation fans already know and love. So it's quite a lot. So we already knew this. This is just a further confirmation of that. And we now know what they mean by PlayStation Studios. Definitely not first-party IP or first-party studios alone. This is also second-party and third party as well. Next up, he is asked, how important is new IP for PlayStation Studios? New IP is incredibly important to us, he says. New IP is the lifeblood of gaming, but new IP is just one aspect of our strategy. Ultimately, I want PlayStation Studios to be fiercely daring, to take risks. I want us to continue to embrace the legacy of PlayStation, pushing the boundaries of gaming, keep making games that matter, games that probably wouldn't have been made anywhere else. And you know, Ben Studio is working on a very exciting new IP that they are very, very passionate about. They're building on the deep open world systems that they developed with Days Gone. So I'm really happy for Ben Studio. And this is where I want to take a moment to discuss this, because I was one of the people who truly believed that Days Gone 2 would happen because of the job postings that were almost identical to describing what Days Gone was. So it seems like they're going to build on that world and, or sorry, they're going to build on that open world system, but it's not going to be Days Gone. It's going to be a new IP. So sorry guys, RIP Days Gone 2. This looks like it's not happening. Maybe in the future, who knows? But it looks like Ben Studio will be working on a new PS5 IP, which, you know, in one way is really exciting too, because we get to see a new world. But at the same time, if you really love Days Gone, it's unfortunate you're not going to see Days Gone 2. So that is a confirmation for you guys from the horse's mouth. No Days Gone 2. Now, next up, he says, how have the teams at PlayStation Studios been able to cope and adapt with these big challenges over the last year? Herman says, perhaps the biggest challenge has been when we need specialist locations, often physical locations, primarily performance capture, audio work. We've come up with some really clever solutions to some of this. We built tiny recording studios in people's houses. But when you're doing performance capture for a lot of cinematics with multiple actors, that's not so simple to solve. So you've got a choice. You could do it later in the schedule, which could cause you problems, or you could risk the final quality by doing it in a different way. But I can tell you, we're not going to risk the quality. We want to ship extremely high quality products, finished games, and we have to do that obviously without pushing our teams to the breaking point. So we have currently two very big, very narrative-driven games in development, Horizon Forbidden West and next God of War, and for both of those, they are frankly affected by access to performance capture and talent. For Horizon, we think we are on track to release this holiday season, but that isn't quite certain yet, and we're working as hard as we can to confirm that to you as soon as we can. Very interesting point. I'm going to interject here. So basically, Horizon is not a guarantee for this year, which we kind of already knew. They're on the fence about it if they're going to be able to do that. God of War, they're saying, you know, it was definitely impacted. And as he says, and for God of War, the project started a little later, so we've made the decision to push that game out to next year to ensure that Santa Monica Studio can deliver the amazing God of War game that we all want to play. So God of War has been confirmed to be delayed. It's delayed to 2022. And he says, with these things, something's gotta give. It cannot be quality for our titles, and it surely won't be the health or well-being of our amazing team. So, you know, they're putting the team first, which is great. Unfortunately, yeah, God of War is delayed, guys. It's a bummer, and that shouldn't come as a surprise, as that's kind of been all over everyone's mind at this point. We've all thought it's kind of strange that they didn't show off anything. So next he's asked, how does PS4 factor into PlayStation Studios development vision? Is it still a focus internally for future game development? Herman says it very much is. You can't build a community of over 110 million PS4 owners and then just walk away from it, right? I think that'd be bad news for fans of PS4 and frankly not very good business. And then he says where it makes sense to develop a title for both PS4 and PS5, for Horizon Forbidden West, the next God of War, and GT7, confirmation right there that Horizon cross-gen we already knew, God of War cross-gen we did not know, GT7 cross-gen we did not know. And he says we'll continue to looking at that, and if PS4 owners want to play that game, then they can. If they want to go on and play the PS5 version, that game will be there for them. That being said, it's also very important to have showpieces for PS5, hence the development of Returnal and Ratchet that are exclusive to PS5. Very interesting point here that they are actually focusing on cross-gen development more than we thought. And, you know, people are feeling a type of way about this. And at the same time, I understand, as I would have loved to see some of these games be PS5 only just to see what could be done. But at the same time, I also understand there's a lot of users on the PS4, and the PS5 is not readily available, so there's that as well. But people feel like they were kind of misled when Sony talked about being about generational leaps and being about moving forward and creating greater game experiences, and this not really being an example of that. And I feel like that, you know, being said, and then these actions does, you know, give people a justified reason for feeling like they were misled. Personally speaking, I think it's great that PS4 and PS5 players are going to be able to enjoy these games. And seeing how good Horizon Forbidden West looked, I'm not too worried about the impact on God of War and GT7. Now, there's only a few more points here left. He's asked, how does PC fit into the world view of PlayStation Studios moving forward? Herman says, we are still early on in our planning for PC, and Horizon Zero Dawn has been very successful. I think it shows that there's an appetite for gamers outside the PlayStation ecosystem to experience the amazing portfolio of games that PlayStation fans have enjoyed for years. But I want to emphasize that PlayStation will remain the best place to play our PlayStation Studio titles at launch. But we do value PC gamers and will continue to look at the right times to launch each game. Ben Studio just released a PC version of Days Gone on May 18th, So that's about 2 years after the PS4 release, and I hope that the new set of fans can and will enjoy that title. And that's the goal. We want to reach new gamers who haven't yet experienced the great stories, characters, and worlds that we've built. Releasing games on PC will not ever come at the expense of building an exciting lineup of great console games. Two very important points here. They made note of it being 2 years after the PS4 release, and maybe that's something we can like kind of see going forward, is exclusives coming 2 years after the release of it on the PS4, PS5. That's kind of interesting, although that doesn't exactly fit into Horizon Forbidden West. I think we'll probably see more of that going forward. Obviously, Uncharted 5 is said to be coming as well, and that's more than 2 years after release. So that's something to keep in mind, but it's nice to see that they are not going to let this be at the expense of console games. And that's really what I expected. I expect nothing less than that. Next up, he has asked, another topic that's been out there recently is Japan. Do you feel that from the PlayStation Studios perspective that Japan is still a big focus for development? Or are you maybe considering a shift to a more Western focus for game development? Herman says, oh no, I want to be very clear that Japanese games and Japanese talent remain extremely important to PlayStation Studios and to Sony Interactive Entertainment. Japan and Asia are strongly associated with our legacy, the success of Sony, the PlayStation brand, and many of our iconic PlayStation franchises were actually born in that region. I remember watching the PlayStation 5 showcase event from last year. It struck me how much Japanese influence there was in the games that we showed and what a key part of PlayStation's DNA that is. It's one of the things that makes PlayStation different, unique in my mind. I know the potential from high quality games from Japan and Asia, and some of the best development talent in the world is found there. They have the history of innovation, of craftsmanship, and skill, the pride and team spirit. We very much want to continue those traditions. Polyphony Digital is such an important part of the PlayStation family, making the best driving simulation games in the world. We're building Team Asobi in Tokyo, a world-class studio that are developing a franchise for all ages and global appeal, such a creative team. And alongside Asobi, we will continue to maintain and build partnerships through our external development team. So I'm really excited about the future of PlayStation games from Japan and Asia, and I'm grateful for the interest and passion and support for our Japanese teams. And lastly, in addition to this, which all ties in and I'll cover that, my thoughts after, is he's asked, great to know, and perhaps that is a redundant question, but it seems like maybe we haven't seen the last of Astro Bot. And Herman says, I hope not. I love that guy. And this is a confirmation, guys, pretty much, that they are working on a game over at Team Asobi that is going to be basically a successor to Astro Bot, the game that we all have been praising. Like, really praising it with the demo of the controller, of the DualSense with the PS5. And so I'm glad to see that they are going to just do a whole experience there, because I feel like that is such an excellent game. And if they can capture all the history of PlayStation and all these different elements and Easter eggs from many different games, it's going to be an amazing experience. So that in itself, to me, is very, very exciting. Now, that's the entire interview. This has been a long video, I know, but I really wanted to cover it thoroughly. I wanted to look at every aspect of this interview so we're not missing anything. And what I take away from this is ultimately, number one, God of War delayed, okay? Because they had troubles with development, right? It's just the reality of it. With everything that's happening in the world, it's hard to develop a game in this climate. Horizon may or may not make it this year. They are not 100% sure. If I'm being honest with you guys, I have a feeling that this is a 50-50 toss-up, that we may get Horizon in 2022. I hope not. I hope we get it this year, but it may have to be pushed to 2022. But I do think that if it is the case that it has to be pushed, then they should do it, because I want that game to be ready when it launches. I don't want all these problems that we're seeing with other games. If they need to delay it, go ahead and delay it. God of War, cross-gen. If God of War needs the delay, like I said, it should be delayed. A cross-gen kind of threw me off. I definitely felt like this might be a PS5 only title, but it turns out no, this is cross-gen, which I'm curious to see how you guys all feel about that. That's an interesting one. I would have loved to see that be a PS5 only game. Gran Turismo 7 cross-gen as well. Whether this game necessarily would have benefited from just being PS5 only, I wonder about that. But it's a cross-gen game, and that's great for people who are going to be able to play that on the PS4 as well. And then of course we've got Astro's Playroom, which, or Astro Bot, which will get its own game from the sounds of it. and that's really exciting. Sony Bend working on a new IP, which is very exciting, and they are definitely looking at continuing to release games over to PC. This is a lot. This is a lot of information, and I'm just going to cut this video off here because I don't want it to go on forever, but I would love to hear your guys' thoughts about this entire interview. Please let me know in detail what you think about all this, because this is so much new info that we're getting. And as always, if you have not subscribed already, please hit that subscribe button, hit that notification bell to get notified about all my upcoming videos, and hit the like button. It helps the channel a ton. You can follow me on Twitter and Twitch. Links will be in the description, and share this video with a friend. I will talk to you all on the next one. Take care.